thank you for your understanding of challenges being faced by Pakistan. I will continue to seek your support mission of bringing peace and prosperity in the world. Regards, Parvez Musharraf. Okay, so I will speak more about it at the end. The second very unusual thing which happened to me was I was a young flying officer in No. 1 Squadron base at a place called Adampur, which is next to Jalandhar in Punjab. And on the 1st of September 1965, a war broke out between Pakistan and India. The Pakistan army invaded across the international border in the Chandaria sector. And for the first 6 days, the air force in Pathankot was heavily involved. But they couldn't hold back the Pakistan army. So Prime Minister Shastri took the bold move to cross the international border on the 6th of September on the Amritsar-Lahore axis as well as the Samba-Sialkot axis. By all tenets of the use of air power, we should have been attacking Pakistani airfields on the 6th morning. As the army was advancing, we should have been shooting up their aircraft on the ground. We didn't do that, and we kept twiddling our thumbs in the crew room, and in the afternoon at 1:30 when we went to the mess for lunch, we heard President Ayub Khan on Pakistan radio saying that India has recklessly swung its air force into action, they have crossed our international border and we have no option but to defend ourselves. So we were waiting for the music to start, and sure enough in the evening they raided Pathankot airfield, we lost 10 aircraft on the ground. Then they attacked Adampur later in the evening, we lost the MiG-21 which was parked at the end of the runway. Then they attacked Halwara, fortunately there we were able to shoot down two of the attacking sabers. Now we were expecting something, the IAF response, and sure enough we were told to go back to our rooms early and get some sleep. We were woken up at 3 a.m. in the morning and called to the squadron to report at 4 o'clock. When I entered the briefing room, I found the details for a 12 aircraft mission and dawn attack on Sargodha. Now, Sargodha is way west of Lahore, and it's about at the limit, very limit of the range of the aircraft I was flying at that time, called the Mystery 48. So the international border is this yellow line you can see here, and Sargodha is way inside. At that time, it was the most heavily defended Pakistani airbase. So, in darkness, the 12 aircraft took off. But unfortunately, my leader, Squadron Leader Handa, he lost his way in the darkness and we came back with our bomb load. During the debrief, our squadron commander, Wing Commander Taneja, got very angry and he said, "Handu, refuel and go back." Now this was a big shock because by now it was broad daylight, there was no cover of darkness, and we had to go. When we were ordered to go back, I was absolutely paralyzed with fear because I was 24 years old and not particularly keen to die. And this was the aircraft that flew 1334. It's got two drop tanks and 2,000 pound bombs hanging under the wings. So, funnily enough, when I went and got into the cockpit and started all the checks and procedures, the fear just dropped away like a curtain. I was concentrating so much on my mission that there was absolutely no fear. It was very strange. So, we took off. At 9:45 in the morning, it was a clear day. We flew at extremely low level, about 100 feet above the ground. And we went right up to Sarvoda. Fortunately, we were not inserted anywhere. And we put in our attack. Now, this is an artist's impression of the attack. We managed to catch the... We were very fortunate that the combat air patrol of one starfighter, which is here, and three Sabre jets, they just landed for refueling. Actually, this artist's impression is slightly wrong because this was at the northern end of the runway there. Anyway, there was a lot of flak. You can see the flak burst all over. And this was the leader who was getting away after putting in his attack. This was number 2, Brar. Number 3, Kahai, my subsection leader. And there I am on the top of the dagger. So, after dropping his bombs, Handa's opening burst caught the middle saber and it burst into flames. And I said, "Sir, you got him." And then Kahai scraped the aircraft, and I think all these 4 aircraft were destroyed. But Pakistan till today has admitted the loss of only 1 saber jet. So after dropping the bomb, as I was pulling out of my dive, Brar, the number 2, reported a bogey. Left 8 o'clock high, you know, left 8 o'clock high. So bogey is an unidentified aircraft, and I said, "Oh God, this is a Pakistani fighter and he's going to intercept us now." But I looked and it wasn't an aircraft, it was just a flak burst. So I said, "Flak." Now, our navigation planning, because of fuel, they're supposed to get away only for 2 minutes at full throttle. But Honda, because of Brar's call, kept full throttle for 8 minutes and I became desperately short of fuel. So I called out that I am very low on fuel, so he throttled back and I was able to catch up. And by now we were getting away at 500 knots at very, very low level, at probably 50-60 feet, because I could see Honda's jet wake parting the standing crop in the fields over which we were flying. So that's how low we were. Now, by the time we were, I'll just go back to that map. By the time when we were somewhere here, I saw a glint in the sky. My job was to look out for aircraft, and I reported a bogey. This time I reported. And Handa said, "Buster." Buster means open full throttle. By this time, my low-level fuel warning light had come, and we crossed the international border, and we overflew Amritsar. Amritsar is somewhere here. And our own anti-aircraft gun started firing at us because Amritsar was a guns-free area. Our radar unit was there. So Arda said, "Raj, you're over Indian territory now. You can eject if you have to." I said, "Thank you very much." Eased up to about 6,000 feet. And fortunately, it was a clear day. I caught sight of Alampur about 15 miles away. I crossed it back, went back and landed. And fuel gauge showed 200 pounds, which is 3 minutes of fuel. We came back to the crew room. Everybody said, "Well done, you've done some damage to the enemy and you come back unscathed." After the debriefing, I went back to the crew room, sat down, grabbed a cup of tea, and I found my hands were shaking. These days, of course, my hands shake without so that was a very exciting event. The second unusual event which happened was when 1981 I was posted to Iraq. And I got an opportunity to fly a Chinese made MiG-21. So we were based at a place called Tikrit. Now Tikrit is north of Saddam Hussein's hometown. Now from Tikrit we were moved to a base here called H2, right in the middle of the Anbar province, which is all desert. And when I was asked to ferry an aircraft there before the rest of the unit moved, and when I went there, there was another officer with me, Indian officer. We were sitting in the mess in the evening when the station commander, a large, florid, full gentleman came, brigadier, and he said, "One of you, I believe, is a test pilot." I said, "Yes, I am." He said, "Will you please take me out? I'll come and pick you up in the morning." He didn't tell me what it was for. And then in the morning, he picked me up and took me to the hangar where there were a large number of bamboo crates which had disassembled MiG-21s inside. They were pulling out the fuselage, the wings and the fin, and Chinese technicians were erecting it. So he said, "This aircraft is ready. Will you air test it for me?" I said, "Sure, show me the flight manual." So he showed me the flight manual. It was all in Mandarin. So that didn't help. Then I went and peeped into the cockpit, and all the markings in the cockpit were also in Mandarin. So I said, "What to do?" Anyway, I got inside, and then I took a closer look at the cockpit, and I found the cockpit was an exact replica of the MiG-21 model we were flying, which was called the F-13, the Russian made one. So I said, "Let me see if all the switches function the way they do in the F-13. So I asked for a battery and a hydraulic card, checked out all the switches, and the ejection seat was Martin Baker, so the ejection seat manual was in English, so that was a help because I could at least know the ejection seat limits. So I then asked for the engine manual. Unfortunately, that was also in Mandarin, but I was able to make out the RPM and the flight temperature figures, oil pressure figures. And I made a little card out of all this, stuck it on my tie, strapped up into the aircraft, started up. It had a Chinese engine called the WP2, and which was a little more powerful than the Russian engine which we were flying. So I gingerly taxied out and checked out the brakes and everything. Everything was fine. Went to the runway, ran up the engine, everything looked good. I released brakes and I got airborne. Strange airfield, strange aircraft, everything in Chinese, but I did the normal air test profile and came back and landed. And the brigadier was very happy. He said, "Will you please air test all the aircraft?" So I air tested four more of them, then I briefed the Indian instructors, and then all of us started flying those. But what I want to tell this audience is that the Chinese had reverse engineered the MiG-21 to such perfection. Now, we've been making MiG-21s in Nasik since 1967, and we've never been able to do something like that. And not only that, they have reverse engineered the engine also, the Russian engine which we've been making in Korapur since 1967, has a time between overall of 250 hours. The Chinese engine had a time between overall of only 200 hours. But yet they had productionized it, put it into service and collected a huge amount of data and experience. We are still struggling to make our first data. So that is the Iraqi story. Then of course, in 1994, as you heard, Dr. Kalam asked for my services and I came to the Light Combat Aircraft Program. Now this is the MiG-21, which the Tejas were supposed to replace, the old leading the new. Now all these little white things are not chalk marks, but they are little bits of aluminium for bonding, because the aircraft have to be bonded well for lightning protection. In case the lightning strikes the aircraft, it should travel through the aircraft out the other side. So bonding has to be very good. And because the wings are made of composites, we have to do all this tamasha to ensure conductivity. Now, here are the three men who are the absolute architects of this program. One is Prime Minister Rajiv Gandhi. This is Dr. V.S. Arunachalam, who was the scientific advisor at that time. And Dr. Kota Hari Narayana, who was the program director. Now, Rajiv Gandhi went to the United States in 1985 and he met President Ronald Reagan. And he requested President Reagan for help, American help, to develop the light combat aircraft. And Raymond was absolutely thrilled that we were embarking on such an ambitious program without going to the Russians. So he said, yes, we will give you all the help. So that was a very politically brave move of Rajiv, because after the 71 war, the relationship with India was very bad. The 1974 Pokhran explosion made it worse, but he still took the initiative and went to America, and we managed to get help from them. Now, Dr. Arunachalam is the one who bit the bullet and said, yes, we will do it. We have the capability to do it. And eventually, subsequent events have proved him right. And here is the indefatigable and enthusiastic leader, Dr. Kota Hari Narayana, who led the program for 16 years in a very, very adverse environment of consistent criticism from all quarters, politicians, media, electronics, the most criticized program in aviation history, perhaps. But he stuck to his guns, and full credit must go to Dr. Kota for getting the first two technology demonstrators into the air and putting the program on a firm footing. Now, the big elephant in the room in the light combat aircraft program was something called the fly-by-wire system, which we were developing in India for the first time. So, I'll just give you a very brief description of what fly-by-wire is all about. Now, in a conventional aircraft, when the pilot moves the stick, there's a direct link through push-pull rods and cables to the control surfaces when they move. But in a fly-by-wire aircraft, there is a flight control computer here. The pilot's input is converted into electrical signals. It goes to the flight control computer. The flight conditions of the aircraft go through the air data here. The response of the aircraft goes through this feedback loop and comes back here. And the pilot also senses the feedback of what the aircraft is doing. So now, when the aircraft is flying at slow speed, the controls have moved to quite a large extent. But as you gather more speed, the deflection required to maneuver the aircraft reduce. Now, the whole trick is to make sure that the controls are deflected to the exact amount required for the flight condition. So, what this black box does is mix pilot demand, air data, and aircraft response and move the control surface to the optimum degree. That is the, in a nutshell, the simplified form of what fly-by-wire does. So, how do we develop the fly-by-wire? The intelligence which is sitting in the computer is called the control law. And to develop the control law, the test pilots have to sit in the simulator. This is the simulator at the Aeronautical Development Agency. It wasn't anything like this in 1994 when I came. It took about 10 years or more of effort to get it to this shape. It has very good visuals, and you can fly the aircraft just as you would fly it in the air. Only thing, you are sitting on the ground and the simulator has a fixed base. Now, the visuals are so realistic in the simulator that when I was flying, if somebody was standing on the side, on a couple of occasions when I did a rapid roll, this person standing outside fell down because it was so realistic, the feeling of flying. So the pilots, we flew something like 2000 hours on the simulator before first flight. And to monitor the flights, we set up a telemetry station. This is the heart of the monitoring system. The test director, who is right here, we call him Ravindra. He was the lead test director for 20 years at ADA, or the National Flight Test Center. And here's this main monitoring screen, then you have a map showing where the aircraft is, then you have two video screens. And there are 16 system specialists monitoring their individual systems. So, it is very rigorous monitoring of every flight, and the use of the simulator, which is resulted in the outstanding safety record of the aircraft. Now, when we reached the stage where we thought the control laws were ready to fly, we went to an American company called CalSpan and we did in-flight simulation. And here's a photograph of me standing next to the American test pilot. His name was John Ball. And this is an F-16 variable stability in-flight simulation aircraft. Now, how does an F-16 fly like an LCA? That is because the handling qualities which a pilot perceives is what the aircraft does in the first 1 to 2 seconds following the control input. So the control engineers are able to tailor the output of the flight control computer and the F-16 to mimic a new aircraft. So we did a tour, and before that we did some more in-flight simulation aircraft called the T-33. And we did a total of about 350 sorties of in-flight simulation. And finally, at the end of this phase, I said the control laws are ready to fly. And at the end of December 24th of December 2000, we held a final meeting of something called the Flight Readiness Review Board. And in that Flight Readiness Review Board, there was the scientific advisor, the chairman HAL, and all the big wigs you can think of, including the chief of the ASTE. And I said, we are ready to fly.
Okay, waiting for roll call.
Clear to go.
Ready. And climbing up.
Today, the Tejas has completed 5,000 test flights and has entered service. Two squadrons are flying with the Indian Air Force. And recently, you must have read in the papers that Hindustan Aeronautics has got an order for 180 aircraft worth 120,000 crores. So, this is a big success story. Now, once we got the aircraft airborne, we had to convert it into a ready to go to war machine. So, here is the Tejas firing an R-73 missile off the coast of Goa. And here is the sequence. Now, unbelievably, the sequence was shot from a photographer standing on the ground. So, it was a very, very low level launch. Probably launched at about 500 meters above the ground. Then we had to have environmental clearance. We went to Leh, flew the aircraft in Leh. Then we had to hang all kinds of stores on it. And each time we had to drop tanks, bombs, missiles. Each time the configuration changed and anything, there was a lot of work required on the fly-by-wire system because the structural response of the airframe changes whenever the load is added. And all those changes that we fitted into the flight control system. So it takes time. Then we did the air-to-air refueling. The Tejas is now cleared for air-to-air refueling. You see the probe, IL-78 tanker refueling the Tejas. And now, this is a nice shot of the Tejas which shows the undersurface and the slats on either side. Now the naval program. The naval LCA, this is a very fine shot of the naval LCA lifting off the ski jump at Goa. Now the person who took this shot, this Sanjay Sima, was sitting somewhere there. He was lying on his back here, just below this. And he says his hair got singed and he almost became deaf with the roar of the engine. Then we built something called the showbiz test facility at Goa, where we put the arresting gear on the ground and we did a number of arrests on the ground, about 40 to 50 of them on the ground. And then here is one where the aircraft is landing on one leg. Now this is not a bad landing, but this is a deliberately one wheel touchdown simulating a box landing on the deck. And this is a night ski jump, you can see the afterburner glow. And finally, on the 20th, on the 11th of January 2020, Commodore Maulankar trapped on the deck of the INS Vikramaditya off the coast of Parwa. This is a phenomenal achievement for Indian naval aviation. And next day he launched from the ski jump of the Vikramaditya. So now I come to the human aspect of the story. These are the extraordinary, some of the extraordinary men and women who made this thing possible. First is Rajiv Kotiyar, who did the first six flights. He left and became an airline pilot. This is Raghu Nambiar, who did the next six flights. He retired as an air marshal. This is Tarun Banerjee, who flew the second technology demonstrator. He also left and became an airline pilot. This is Sunit Krishna, who is here. He was the first pilot to complete 500 flights of shoulder type testing on the Tejas. And who's this?
Chhotu
Bhaduria. This is Chhotu Bhaduria, who also was project director at NFTC. He became the chief of the air staff. And this is Vikram Singh, who just retired as an air marshal. He was the first fellow to cross 150 flights. And here is Rituraj Tyagi, who did 653 flights of prototype testing. And this is R. K. Sharma. He retired as the vice chief of the air staff. And
Who's this?
Harish.
Harish Nayaka?
Oh, yeah.
Sorry, that is Harish Nayani and this is Krishna.
No.
Harish. I can't make out from here. Yeah. And this is AP Singh, who is likely to be the next chief. And this is Commodore Maulanka. He is the man who did all the naval NCA work. And this is another Tiwari, who is now AO Singh of Southwest Senior Command. And here is Rohit Varma, who was responsible for all the first landings at Leh, and he did a lot for the program. This is George Thomas, who is a serving Air Vice Marshal now. And this chap is
Ankur
Jain, who is also a naval pilot who was involved in the naval program. Now, these guys have this motto: it has always been about doing dangerous things safely. That sort of sums up the philosophy of the National Flight Test Center and the extraordinary people who manned it. Now I tell you something about the extraordinary women in the program. All these ladies are masters in engineering, many of them are PhDs. Extremely intelligent, extremely hardworking, and they made a huge contribution to the program. Now, I'll just pick out three ladies here. This lady is Revati Vivekanandan, and she was involved in developing the telemetry software, which, you know, when the aircraft is flying, all that it is sending down is only a series of zeros and ones, so that we convert it into individual parameters displayed in engineering units. All that requires a software pipeline, and Revati was working on that. Now, sometime in early 2000, she came to me and said, "Sir, I'm expecting my second child." I said, "Oh God, Revati, whom am I going to replace you with?" She said, "Don't worry, sir, I'll just take 1 week before my baby is due, and 2 weeks after she comes, I'll be back at work." And she was back. Within 3 weeks was all the leave she took, and she was back. Extraordinary lady. And this lady here is Sundari Vivekananda from Thrissur Engineering College. She developed most of the weapon aiming algorithms. She led the team which developed the weapon aiming algorithms. Another very, very committed lady. And this lady is Deepa James, who's an aerodynamicist, and she did a lot of work on the separation studies of stores where they drop from the aircraft. So these are, and there are only a few, there are only a dozen of them I'm showing here, but there are about 60 or 70 of them at ADA. All of them are extremely intelligent, extremely well qualified, extremely hardworking. And the short point I would like to make is that any society which does not tap into this huge potential of womankind can never realize its full potential. Now, I come to my Pakistan story. In 1990, the Air Force sent me to the Royal College of Defence Studies for a year-long course. Two Indians, there was a Brigadier Malik with me, and then two Pakistanis landed up there. One was Air Commodore Aliuddin from the Pakistan Air Force, and Brigadier Parvez Musharraf from the Pakistan Army. And we used to live in the same housing, British Army housing, in Kingston upon Thames. And we visited each other's house, went to parties together, we drank whiskey together, played golf together. Parvez Musharraf was like any Indian service officer, whiskey drinking, golf playing, dog loving service officer, no difference. Now, when he became president of Pakistan, every 5 years we hold a reunion. So we had reunions in 95 and 2000, which I couldn't attend because I was still in uniform. In 2005, when we were in London, my wife and I were visiting London, when we got a message from the college saying that the next reunion is in Pakistan, would you like to go? I said, "I don't have time to go to Bangalore and apply for a visa. They said, don't worry, go to the Pakistan High Commission in London and submit your passports, and the next day we got the passport stamp because the orders had come from the President's office. So, we came back to Bangalore and 2 days later we flew to Islamabad via Lahore. And we had a marvelous time. Parel was still in uniform, still the army chief. Very important point to remember. Because in Pakistan, everything is controlled by the army. So he continued to live in Rawalpindi in the Pakistan army chief's house. And he put us all up. We were 16 couples in the President's Palace in Islamabad, which is the equivalent of our Rashtrapati Bhavan. And Sheila and I went into this huge bedroom with chandeliers and carpets and liveried servants everywhere. And we started giggling like school children, you know, say, where the hell have we landed up, you know? It's an amazing experience. Now, what I want to tell you particularly about is the lead up, the run up to the 1971, December 71 war. In February of 71, the Air Chief at that time, Air Chief Marshal Pratap Lal, he established a very elite unit called the Tactics and Combat Development Establishment, whose only job was to develop new tactics for the Air Force. So to form that unit, they chose 5 MiG pilots and 5 Sukhoi pilots, and I was one of the MiG pilots posted to that unit. And sometime in August, Pratap Lal came to the squadron and said, I'll handpick you guys, you will carry out single aircraft night bombing raids over Pakistani airfields. And we were based in Ambala, we were supposed to take off from Amritsar, fly for 23 to 25 minutes and hit Chaklala, Sargodha, and a place called Sarkot Road. Now, the whole of Punjab was blacked out on our side and their side, and we were practicing this low-level navigation, just looking at the compass and the stopwatch in complete darkness. And the target assigned to me was Chaklala. I was supposed to take off from Amritsar, hit Chaklala and come back. Now, once we were in Islamabad, Parvez organized us to go to Chitral. Now, Chitral is right up there at the base of the Hindu Kush Mountains, and we sighted this Pakistani Air Force C-130 aircraft all strapped up, and Ali Uddin said, hey Raj, would you like to come to the cockpit? I just jumped at the opportunity, went and sat behind these two bearded Pakistani pilots in the jump seat, and we started rolling down the runway at Chaklala. Then it struck me, I said, oh man, this is the runway I was supposed to bomb. Rather strange experience. Then we went to Chitral, we went to the Shandur polo match, we were flown in helicopters to a very remote valley where the Kalash tribe, the three valleys where the Kalash tribe still lives, they're supposed to be remnants of Alexander the Great's army. They all have blonde hair and blue eyes, and they are still there, and they are trying to do DNA studies to find out where these people came from. And from there we went to Peshawar and we went to the Khyber Pass, and standing there looking at the Khyber Pass, I was overcome by a sense of history, because you know this is how Alexander the Great's armies came, how Mohammed Ghori and Mohammed Ghazni, Tamil Delane, Nader Shah, Babur, a whole lot of them came that way. So it's a very historic place. And Khyber Pass is not some tiny pass. It is 36 kilometers long, and the average height is only 3,600 feet, just 600 feet more than Bangalore. So that was a great experience. And in Chitral, when we were in Chitral, I got just a 10-minute window with Parvez, because he was always surrounded by his people. I said, Parvez, what do you want to do about Kashmir? He said, now I'm repeating his exact words. He said, Arey yaar, before I make peace with India, I have to make peace with my own people. Ye log manta nahi hai, he said. That means the Pakistan army, his own people, does not want peace with India because then they become irrelevant. Then he lost power in 2008. We met again in Stockholm in 2010. That was the last time I met him. He said, Dr. Manmohan Singh and I had come very close to solving the Kashmir issue, but unfortunately I had to step down. So that is my interaction with Pervez Musharraf. And I end my talk there and I take any questions. And any questions which I am not able to answer about the program, I request my friend Ravindran and Group Captain Sunil Krishna to help me out with the answers.
So have you flown the